morning and welcome to ITIF. My name is Stephen Ezel. I'm the Vice President of Global Innovation Policy. And we thank you for joining us today for a conversation about Bill Bonvillian and Chuck Weiss's new book, Technological Innovation in Legacy Sectors. I was privileged to be one of the original reviewers for the book for Oxford, so I got to see one of the first copies, and I can tell you that it's a fantastic book. It's a wonderfully important book. It breaks new ground in our understanding of innovation, of innovation systems, and of innovation policy. It says correctly, I think, that too often U.S. innovation has been focused on the big shiny objects, the new frontier sectors, and we need to spend much more time thinking about how we can bring systemic innovation to the legacy sectors, which account for much as two-thirds of U.S. GDP. So let me introduce then Chuck and Bill and David Hart and J.J. Rayner, and then I'll turn it over to you guys for your presentation. So first, Bill Bonvillian, since January 2006, has been the director of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology's Washington, D.C. office. At MIT, he works to support MIT's strong and historic relations with federal R&D agencies and its role on national science policy. Prior to working for MIT, he served for 17 years as legislative director and chief counsel to U.S. Senator Joseph Lieberman. Chuck Weiss, seated to his left, was distinguished professor of science, technology, and international affairs at the Georgetown University School of Foreign Service until he retired in 2014. He was DEA director from 1997 to 2006, and before that, a science and technology advisor to the World Bank. He is a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and a member of the Council of Foreign Relations. Commenting first will be David Hart, who is the professor and director of the Center for Science and Technology Policy at the School of Policy, Government, and International Affairs at George Mason University. Professor Hart served as assistant director for innovation policy with focus on advanced manufacturing at the Office of Science and Technology Policy under President Obama from July 2011 to August 2012. And finally, we'll hear from J.J. Rayner, who is still in the White House today. She has served as a special assistant to the President for Economic Policy at the National Economic Council. And before that, she worked as a jobs and workforce fellow at McKinsey & Company. I want to mention finally that we will be live tweeting this event using hashtag innovation systems. So post that for every brilliant comment that Bill and Chuck make in the coming half hour. So thank you, and Bill, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Steve. My mother might have recognized those remarks. I'm not sure anyone else would. Appreciate them. So we're here to talk about how would you spur technological innovation in the legacy sectors that tend to dominate the U.S. economy, but other world economies. So there's a couple of underlying issues that we ought to talk about. The U.S., as Steve suggested, is good at the next big thing. We don't like our neighborhoods. We move on across the mountains, and we open up and settle territory. We're, in effect, a covered wagon kind of economy. We have a covered wagon approach to technology. Open up new areas, we bring new technologies into these new areas. And the U.S. could be a lot better at this, but we're pretty good at it. And there's nothing really quite like computing before computing. And that's these new frontier areas are what we tend to focus on. You're in a legacy sector, the new innovations have to land in what's in effect occupied territory, and the technologies have to parachute in, and they'll get shot at, inevitably, on the way down. So the U.S. is not nearly as good at going back east over the mountains in the other direction. We're pretty good at going west over the mountains, opening up the territory. We're not nearly as good at going back east. We just don't do the west to east. The U.S. would do a biotechnology revolution rather than go back and fix the healthcare delivery system. Right? yet there's huge economic gains from tackling the task of bringing innovation, and innovation, as everybody in this room knows, is the dominant driver of economic growth, technological innovation, well-established in the economics literature. So by only focusing on a comparatively small part, the frontier part of our economy to bring innovation in, and waiting for these sectors to expand, we're limiting our ability to grow and expand. You know, can we innovate our way out of these big 21st century problems that we've got? So there's the economic argument, but there are all these kind of big public issues, climate, including food and water, the issue we're facing of what's been called, what we call jobless innovation, the whole issue of healthcare delivery, improving education, addressing inequality, these big kind of big public issues, they belong to the legacy sector. So unless we innovate in these legacy sectors, we're going to have a great deal of difficulty in tackling these problems. So as one reviewer of the book put it, we have to confront these legacy sector barriers, and they're hidden in plain sight. They're in front of us. So the task we try to undertake in the book is to try to think our way through, are there some common mechanisms we ought to use in trying to bring innovation to legacy sectors. We have some examples where this has worked. The Defense Department, which we argue fits the legacy sector model, was able to do what it called a revolution in military affairs in the 1990s. There are sectors where we really see the potential for new innovation. Legacy sectors where we can start to glimpse entry of disruptive innovation. Areas like advanced manufacturing, new energy technologies, driverless cars, commercial space, online education, we can start to see the possible entry into those established legacy sectors. So with that introduction, let me turn this over to Chuck.
Well, it turns out that there's been a lot of scholarship that's relevant, but in order to this, the problem that Bill set forth, but in order to create a framework for considering what you have to do to innovate in legacy sectors, we had to build on and pull together the work of many earlier scholars to create an overall framework. And this framework was used to explain the fact that there are many common features, many common obstacles to innovation in the legacy sectors which we identified for. The distinguishing features of this framework is that it looks not just at research and development, but also the entire innovative process, from R&D through prototype, invention, demonstration, testbed, all the way to market launch. And we had to look explicitly at the active role of government in the many models of innovation dynamics that we had to develop, the familiar pipeline, the Verne Vautin's induced innovation model, but some new models that we had to develop, the extended pipeline, manufacturing-led innovation, which is a neglected area, and another new organization, a new model called innovation organization, all of which we will explain. And finally, and very importantly for legacy sectors, we needed to explore the effect of innovation context on the demand side for innovation. Because this innovation context has as much to do with the speed and the direction of innovation as the quality of the innovation system, which gets most of the attention of theorists and researchers. This context is multidimensional. It has an economic dimension, a political dimension, legal, cultural dimension, and it sets the framework within which the economy either favors, enables, or disables innovation. Which button do I press on this thing? The right one. Well, we're going to be in the weeds quite a lot, so I want to start off by telling you what the take-home lesson is. First of all, legacy sectors are important and deserve more attention from researchers and policymakers. Second of all, when you look across quite disparate legacy sectors, you find that the obstacles to innovation in them have a lot in common, and we'll talk about this in a minute. A third, as I said a minute ago, the context of innovation is as important as the system. Fourth, manufacturing is a legacy sector, is of particular importance as a source of jobs and also as a source of innovation. And finally, we have to look at the entire innovation process. You have to look at R&D, but you also have to think ahead and ask, what are the likely barriers to innovation that we can foresee that will face a given innovation as it proceeds to market more? And if you can, anticipate and start to forestall. Okay, so what are the characteristics of these legacy sectors? First of all, they provide incentives to producers that do not align with social objectives. They are well positioned to resist disruptive innovation. They are well entrenched and well defended. And they are defended by a paradigm, which again is a multidimensional paradigm. It has a technological dimension, has an economic, a political, a social, a cultural, a legal paradigm, probably some dimensions we've left out. And the elements in this paradigm are listed in the next bullet point. Their institutions, their infrastructures, policies, public attitudes, knowledge systems, career paths, political support, and a whole bunch of market imperfections. Now, that doesn't mean that innovation doesn't take place in legacy sectors. An innovation that fits the business model will do beautifully. Fracking is a good example. It fits the fossil fuel business model very well, and it's going like gangbusters. But if an innovation is disruptive, if it doesn't fit the prevailing business model, and especially if the innovation is driven by non-market objectives, by environment, by public health, by safety, these disruptive innovations may face very serious barriers. Why? Because the obstacles are defended by important vested interests. Now, I want to take just a moment to address something that you sometimes hear. If the government would just get out of the way, innovation would proceed beautifully, and we'd all be better off. Well, as we'll see, sometimes government does get in the way. But government is also an important instrument to promote innovation and to direct into objectives and directions that we approve of. So you have to unpack that statement when you hear it. So what are some of these legacy sectors in the U.S.? The ones we treat are gradually appearing in this slide as it wakes up, so to speak. Fossil fuel energy is the standard. We will talk about manufacturing. The long-distance interstate electric grid is an important legacy sector. Transport, higher ed, health delivery, buildings, agriculture, and defense is an interesting chimera. If you add all these up, you're talking about more than half of the economy. And it stands to reason that if you can't innovate in these sectors because of resistance, you're dragging down your economic growth, you're dragging down your job creation, and clearly you're dragging down your response to environment, to safety, to public health, and other important public goods. So what are these common features that we find in the legacy sectors? Well, the slide lays them out. You have perverse subsidies. A perverse subsidy is a subsidy for something you really don't want to happen, like overgrazing. You have well-established infrastructure that favors the legacy technology, public habits and expectations, financing mechanisms that are geared to the requirements of the familiar, well-entrenched sectors. You have a human resource sector structure and a knowledge structure that builds on public expectations of where the careers are. All of these are favoring this established technology. All of them are backed by vested interests. If you you want to use an economic lens, you find market imperfections, again, that favor the legacy technology, network economies, non-appropriability, meaning I make the investment and you get the gains, and I can't pass the costs on to you. Lumpiness, which means that there's a minimum investment size, needs for collective action. We'll talk about those as they affect specific sectors. Now, if you're a specialist in any of these areas that I've identified as legacy sectors, you're very familiar with how they affect that sector, that industry. I think our contribution here is to say, look, here's a list of very disparate sectors, a very different bunch of economic activities, and they all share the same characteristic. Well, the poster child for this kind of thing is the fossil fuel industry, which is worth looking at in some detail. The subject of a book that Bill and I wrote in 97, I think, came out.
2007,
yes. Not that old. The characteristics that identify fossil fuels as a legacy sector. Perverse prices. Most obvious one of which is the absence of a carbon charge. An established infrastructure that supports coal, natural gas, gasoline cars, and so on. Public expectations of cheap energy. It's our God-given right to have cheap energy in the United States. Career paths, university curricula that are well established for fossil fuels. Regulatory requirements that make it difficult for wind and solar. Wind farms, solar farms are typically far from the grid. You have to at least, I'm not talking about household solar, obviously. You have to string high tension wires a long distance. Each county has its own permitting requirement, and so on. Relatively limited research and development relative to the importance and the size of the sector, and of course you have very powerful oil companies that have been for years busy telling you that climate change was a hoax. If you frame these as market imperfections, you find perverse subsidies, for example, the oil depletion allowance. You find problems with network economies. You have to set up charging stations for electric cars. You find issues of non-appropriability affecting conservation investments. A landlord or a builder can't pass on to the tenant or the purchaser the extra costs of insulation. You have important instances of lumpiness that affect, say, carbon capture and sequestration, next generation nuclear, and enhanced geothermal, all of which would require very expensive demonstration projects to prove that they're safe and that they're environmentally sustainable, and nobody's going to undertake these multi-billion dollar investments when they know perfectly well that the chances of carbon charges in the near future are not very high. Needs for collective action, the solar people, the wind people, don't get together very well to promote research. The characteristics of the venture markets are an interesting obstacle. Our venture markets, venture capital markets, work beautifully for IT, for information technology, for biotech, five to 7 year time horizon. But if you're into a 10 or 15 year time horizon, they don't have time for that. Now, we looked at many other legacy sectors in our book. They're listed there. I'm colorblind, but I think that's red. The electric grid, where you find very interesting non-appropriability issues that have to do with the nature of the fragmented nature of regulation. If my state makes an investment in a long-distance grid that benefits your state, my regulators won't approve it. That's the non-appropriability. Industrial agriculture, the U.S. Department of Agriculture does a very good job of defending advancing the technology for industrial agriculture. The organic agriculture people have trouble getting together to do research on organic agriculture themselves or to influence the USDA to do it for them. Health delivery systems, very serious network economy issues, especially trying to find interoperable standards for example, digital patient records. Higher education, which was my industry for a long time, introducing MOOCs or other innovations into a faculty that's used to doing it its way has created certain institutional problems. Buildings, again, serious amount of appropriability issues. And the military is an interesting chimera. The services are pushing their, are defending their own missions. They do very good research within their own business models, with, so to speak. But if you're pushing something like a stealth bomber or an intercontinental ballistic missile or a nuclear submarine, you'd better have a change agent that's willing to push very hard against against the system. And here DARPA is a great help. Now, here I want to talk briefly about the idea of an innovation context and how this contrasts with the more familiar idea of the innovation system. We know what the innovation system is. It's all the firms and institutions and policies that get research going, that support it, that encourage it, and so on, including IP, for example. There's lots of research on that. A lot less research, although it's known, it's typically acknowledged, but a lot less research on how innovation is affected by the broader political, economic, social, legal context. And this is very important in determining whether innovation takes place, and when it does take place, whether it's going to help environmental objectives, whether it's going to help public health objectives, and so on. This context can enable this kind of innovation, or it can disable it. And legacy sectors, by definition, suffer from a disabling innovation context. Well, here are some elements within the innovation system and the innovation context. I'm running out of time. I'll assume you know all about the innovation system. What are useful things in the innovation context? Well, you want a stable, reasonably honest political system. You want a sound and stable macroeconomic environment, especially good business laws, bankruptcy laws, very important, a serious tax system. And you want, of course, physical infrastructure, connectivity, and finance. On the legal side, you want good labor and commercial laws. You want sensible immigration laws. All of these affect whether you're going to be able to have innovation. Even the pension system is important, because if you have an inflexible pension system, as you have in many countries, people can't move from job to job because they can't take their pensions with them. Critical point, cultural attitudes, especially attitude toward risk. And we'll see when we talk about the American system, how our success in our kind of innovation is critically dependent on not only the fact of a large market and a flexible labor market and so on, but a social and cultural context that welcomes novelty, that understands competition and welcomes it, that it's proud of disruption and individualism, and most importantly, that it accepts the risk of failure. A lot of countries, you start a business and you fail, you're finished for life. America, you probably have another, the bank will probably figure that your second idea will benefit from your failure with the first one. And this enables us to overcome a lot of negatives in our innovation context, a spotty educational system, the crumbling physical infrastructure, not so hot IT connectivity, neglect of legacy and environment. And perhaps most fundamentally, the fact that the people and the policymakers don't really understand how government affects the innovative process. I think it's time to turn things over to the other member of our, one more slide. There are countries which have clearly negative innovation context, of which the most obvious are the kleptocratic regimes in Russia and in many parts of North Africa. But even in Germany and in China and in France, there are elements of the innovation context that makes it difficult for them to do the kind of cutting edge innovation of which the US is pretty good, although they have their own strengths from which we can learn. Germany and China in manufacturing, China in infrastructure, China and France in infrastructure. Now I turn things back to Bill, the other member of our tag team.
So I want to talk, but if we're going to tackle legacy sectors, we need to better understand the dynamics of the innovation process itself. And we pose five kinds of models of these innovation dynamics, two of which are well established, but we're familiar to folks in this room, three of which are kind of new approaches. The first, what we could call the pipeline, we all know it's not truly pipeline, it's not truly linear, but it's a useful catchphrase that captures the idea that there is technology push, technology supply. Typically this model explains how federally supported research pushes new technology advances towards the marketplace, and sometimes it's picked up that new technologies can in effect push into these markets. It's a technology supply term approach. That's the dominant model in US innovation policy. That's the model that's studied most. Economist Vernon Rutan used the other kind of classic model, what we could call induced innovation. That's a technology pull, a demand pull. Industry spots a market niche. Technology advances, which are often incremental advances, get pulled to meet that market niche opportunity. So obviously, government-funded research is by no means the only way that innovations occur. Lots and lots of innovation, majority of innovation, comes out of industry, of course. And that's kind of typically the way in which that's undertaken. The next model that we talk about in the book is the extended pipeline. And the US is really running sort of two parallel systems on that pipeline side. The model which just does the basic research and throws it over the monastery wall and hopes the industry will pick it up, that's the dominant model. But the Defense Department, to a lesser extent the Agriculture Department, run a very extended pipeline system. So the Defense Department will support the research and support the development, will support the prototype, it will support the demonstration, it will support the test bed, and it will often create the initial market, right? So that's a highly connected system, very different from the Beaver-Bush pipeline concept. A fourth model we posit is manufacturing-led innovation. Particularly initial production can be very innovative. When you're trying to design a product to fit a market, you often have to do very advanced engineering. You often have to completely redo the science. It's a very creative kind of stage. For example, Japan's creation of quality manufacturing is a very good example of manufacturing-led innovation. The US creation in the second half of the 19th century of the mass production model is another very good example of manufacturing-led innovation. So this is an important resource, an important part of innovation that we often don't acknowledge. To tackle innovation in the legacy sector, we need to have another approach that captures, that encompasses, we argue, all the other four models. Right? If you're working in a frontier sector, you can do pipeline and maybe extended pipeline. But with a legacy sector that's established with established firms, you're going to need to think about the other four models. And this model goes beyond those individual models to take account of a broader context and structure And in effect, you need change agents within a legacy sector system that will orchestrate the kind of full innovation environment and the actors within it to move towards innovation. And we'll push towards some more understanding of this. So let me talk about one particular example. Obviously, there's many case studies in our book. We're going to kind of highlight manufacturing and what we call full spectrum innovation, you know, for the next few minutes. Manufacturing, as we discussed, is a legacy sector. But what's interesting about it is that it's also a model of the innovation dynamics. So it falls into kind of both categories. So the U.S. historically thinks of R&D as innovation. We think it occurs in the R&D stage. But obviously, as I discussed a couple minutes ago, it can occur in that, particularly that initial production stage as you're moving towards the market and designing your product. Many countries have manufacturing-led innovation systems. Germany, Japan, Taiwan, China, all organize their innovation systems around their manufacturing system. After World War II, the U.S. organized its innovation system to do what we could call full spectrum innovation. So we would innovate here, and we would produce here, and we would capture the full gains from that innovation system. Since that time, particularly given the IT revolution and the capabilities that it produces, we have been increasingly moving towards what we could call a innovate here, produce here system, that we figured out how to do distributed production. And the innovate here, produce there model leads to a weakening in the industrial ecosystem. So it leads to small and medium-sized enterprises that are more isolated. It leads to what we can characterize as jobless innovation because we're not capturing the full spectrum of gain. And it's, you know, it's a challenge. It's a hollowing out of this manufacturing sector, even though that sector is actually an important part of that innovation system. So, the period of 2000 to 2010 was characterized by very significant job loss. Obviously, we're creating a lot of firms. The software firms we're creating are obviously significant and important, but manufacturing remains the largest job multiplier. And manufacturing is the way that an economy scales up rapidly, right? You can produce, you know, zero iPods in one day and 14 million 3 weeks later, right? That's the way the economy scales. The services sector, most parts of the service sector scale much more slowly. So if you lose this manufacturing strength, you lose a lot of your ability to scale quickly. So the loss of full spectrum innovation causes problems in job creation, in the speed because of the scaling factor in economic recovery. It affects your innovation capacity because it's one of the dynamics of innovation. And it leads to a risk of produce there, innovate. So that's kind of a dive into the manufacturing sector, but that leads us to some implications. Stimulating innovation in legacy sectors requires a full spectrum innovation policy. You need to fill the system gaps. You need to think about a governmental role that moves beyond simply the pipeline model. And then you need to think about policies that remove obstacles to market. The launch process of moving innovations into legacy sectors, we argue, requires a five-step framework. Step one, you know, you're not going to innovate in a sector unless there are innovations. So you are going to have to pay attention to the front end of the innovation system. And obviously that means undertaking research and development, but we believe it entails some other factors as well. Forming critical innovation institutions and organizations that can really contribute in a more organized way to the innovation process. Using the island bridge model, you know, you want to protect your innovators and put them on a protected island, but you want to make sure they've got a bridge back to decision makers that can move on the way of the technologies. Building a thinking community, building a community around the technologies that are evolving so you take advantage of group inputs into the process. Linking the technologists to operators so that you don't have standalone researchers there linking and thinking about the operator's needs and the process. All of this requires more connected science and technology than the U.S. system normally entails based on its historic pipeline. Launching innovation in the legacy sectors requires some more steps, right? So get the front end right, but then a lot of work begins. What are the launch pathways for the emerging sectors, right? How do you tie support policies to the technology launch pathways, right? So the launch pathways are going to be different for every technology. Maybe you can group them, but what are the policies and approaches you want to tie to each of those launch pathways? And then look at the gaps in the innovation system itself. Who are the actors? What are their strengths and weaknesses? What are the gaps in that innovation system? Fill those gaps is the first step. So that's essentially the five-step process. I'll skip some work on the advanced manufacturing territory, which we can come back to if you like. And let me just sort of start on a wrap up here. Chuck, do you want to take the first of these, and I'll stand by with the second.
Okay, wrapping up, legacy sectors, definition, importance, the resistance to innovation unless it fits this multidimensional paradigm. Number two, they share a series of barriers and market imperfections that favor the legacy technology. Third, a new idea, the innovation environment, which is the sum, which we define as the sum of the innovation context and the innovation system, which are important influence on the speed and the direction of innovation. And finally, the idea that you can find legacy sectors in all economies, ours, but also in European economies and in the Asian economies about which we are suddenly worried.
Just to complete the wrap up, for innovation to enter legacy sectors, we argue that you need to understand the five models and the dynamics of innovation and apply them. Those are the pipeline induced, extended pipeline, manufacturing led, and then this kind of all-encompassing category of kind of orchestrating innovation organization. Legacy sectors require the innovation, this innovation organization. Manufacturing, as we've discussed today, is particularly interesting because it's both a legacy sector and it's a model for innovation. And it also happens to be a jobs driver. Not necessarily directly at the production moment, but through the value chains that manufacturing creates. And bringing innovation into legacy sectors, we argue, requires this five-step framework, strengthening early stage innovation, understanding the launch pathways, tying policies to support and approaches to support public and private, support those launch pathways, looking at the gaps in the innovation system itself, and then moving to fill those gaps. That's our step.
Fantastic. Great, thank you, and thanks, Stephen, for inviting me. I'm going to offer some thoughts and questions on three themes, I guess from a more academic perspective. But I want to begin by just saying that it's quite impressive that you got it done. Two books on really important themes, both of which are extremely ambitious, and they pull together an incredible array of threads, things that a lot of us have talked about, and you know, that I teach, but I haven't had them in one package before, so I wanted to just express my admiration to
And it makes a great textbook for your class.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. The royalties, now that I've built the
royalties, are rolling in.
So let me talk about three things very, very briefly. So the first thing I think that they've accomplished that I want to feature is that they're setting a new agenda. We need to talk about these legacy sectors, but not very many people do. ITIF, I think, has done more than most places to think about productivity as a important variable for policy to focus on across the whole economy. And I would include academics like myself in this category, a lot of us are chasing these bright and shiny objects of the the high-tech sector. Also, they're bringing to the fore some issues that we don't focus on too much. So they're truth tellers, which we need more of, and they're also metaphor makers. So they didn't do too much in this presentation, but other times I've seen them present, there's more wagons, there's more parachutes. So the wagons are familiar from Vannevar Bush, who was interested in the frontier, but the parachutes are new. So invading occupied territory, very, very military metaphors there. So I thought that was interesting. I guess I would press a little bit on the theme of jobless innovation and whether this provides a solution to that problem. It is a problem that we should be talking more about, I think, but it's a risky thing to talk about as well in the innovation policy circle. So for example, someone pointed out to me that the largest category, occupational category for non-college educated males is truck driver. So what happens when we have robotic vehicles driving across the country? It's not totally clear to me that innovation will address that job problem, or whether there, at a minimum, there will be a major transition issue to deal with. So that would be one question on the agenda side. So that's the first thing I wanted to mention. Second, about the models. So clearly, there's a move beyond the one-size-fits-all model, or the pipeline model. Now, we've declared the linear model dead many times, and I'm not going to go so far as to declare that they've killed it once and for all, because it has an amazing way of, we should call it the vampire model, because it's constantly rising from the dead.
Can we steal that to me?
Yeah, absolutely.
That'll make a great Halloween
there
slide.
There you go. So they offer a five-part typology of innovation models. So I guess there's a little question here, which is whether that's too complicated for Washington to handle. Can we handle it? I know academics have, we can get to four-part models with the two-by-two matrix, but I don't know about a five-part model. So we have five models offered up, and I would offer just some questions around those. One is whether we need to distinguish more between services and manufacturing sectors, whether the context and the production processes are so different between services and manufacturing that they need to be thought of somewhat differently. Related point, what about linkages among sectors? So some of the other model typologies that we have out there think about one sector providing innovation to the other sector. So we would think about linkages between the IT sector on the one hand and higher education, or electric power with smart grid. So what can we add a component here that thinks about the linkages among sectors? And then the third point is there's an awful lot of stuff baked into the last model, especially the challenge of overcoming various externalities. This orchestrator has an awful lot to do, and I wonder whether that one also needs to be further unpacked and dealt with if we're thinking about the energy system. In addition, you went through a list of externalities, but it's not totally clear how this one orchestrator can overcome all of those challenges. So that's on the models. And then the third thing that I want to highlight, and I really think is a contribution here, is to think about this as a dynamic process. Awful lot of the work in this field is very static. So you've got, again, some great terminology. You've got change agents. You've got launch pathways. Very, very dynamic, and nothing is automatic. And I think that's really important. So somebody has to do something for innovation to flourish, whether it's an individual like Steve Jobs or Elon Musk. But sometimes it's an organization, and I know Bill at least has been involved, and maybe Chuck as well, in setting up organizations like RPE, like the National Network for Manufacturing Innovation. So sometimes that change agent is a policymaker or an advocate. And I think the next step there, and all this is about breaking what some people might call lock-in, right? So we're thinking about political, social, cultural dimensions. I think we have to move from individual change agents to thinking about coalitions, to thinking about movements. So it's not an individual entrepreneur alone that gets this done. It's a very complex package of actors. And so maybe the next step on this agenda to think more about those coalitions, institutional strategies, and so on. So again, setting the agenda, coming up with a new set of models, and making these models dynamic, I think they're all great contributions. And buy the book, take it home. Don't just don't just put it, you know, just don't just put it as a status symbol on your desk. But actually, I know it is a status symbol.
It's an honor to be a status symbol.
So, but read it and enjoy it.
Thanks, Steve.
Well, first of all, I would like to say it's a privilege to be here, and thank you, Steve, for hosting us. ITIF is the thought leader in this space in a way that the administration continues to leverage as we think about our innovation policy. But also, I would say that it's incredible to be here discussing Bill's book. It feels like the numerous coffee chats and advice that so many of DC, especially in the innovation policy space, have benefited from are now out there for public consumption in this space. And so kudos to Bill and Charles for putting that together so that this can be something we all can learn from and benefit from. I thought I'd spend just a little bit of time drilling down on a few important points that Bill and Charles have made that I think resonate, particularly from a policymaker perspective. And I know, David, you sort of touched on a few of these as well, but the first and foremost is just really drilling down on the stakes for innovation, what actually the impact can be for the economy, also for middle-class incomes, which is a key metric that we use to think about, especially in a time when jobs growth has fast exceeded wage growth. So just to put it in perspective, from the 1950s to 1970s, if you look at sort of the 90% of earners who aren't in the top 10%, it's a pretty good metric for median household income, in that 25-ish span of time, they saw their incomes double. It was one of the fastest periods of productivity growth in our history, spurred by many of the innovations that came out with significant public investments as well as private development from World War II and a sustained period of public investment behind growing that pipeline. Had income growth and distribution stayed the same in the next 25 years as it did during that first 25-year period, U.S. household incomes today would be roughly double. That would be an additional $50,000-ish of income for the typical American household. Now, some of that's distributional effects, you know, roughly $10,000 if you hadn't had the decoupling of productivity and income growth that you saw in the 2000s. I think this hits an important point that David brought up, which is we need to think more critically there about how to ensure innovation continues to translate into broadly shared prosperity. But just the innovation side alone, if you had seen productivity growth grow close to 2% as it did from the 1950s and 1970s versus less than 1% annually as it did from the 1970s to the early 2010s, the average household income or median income would have been $30,000 higher. Think about what that translates into for the typical American. So the stakes could not be greater here as we think about trying to restore that pace of innovation and productivity growth and to actually take many of those innovations that came from that highly corrupt spell and continue to put them and cast them more widely into these legacy sectors. But the other, I think, critical piece that comes out of the focus that Bill and Charles have on legacy sectors is thinking through not only how can we restore that productivity growth, but also what that productivity growth would mean in many of these sectors for your typical household. If you think about the markers of, say, you know, being part of the middle class, that can mean, you know, having a car, having an education, having access to great healthcare. And those are all places where I think, as Bill and Charles point out, we've struggled to see the gains of innovation really translate into benefits for households. So just to put some numbers on it, 20 years ago, the U.S. spent roughly 9% of GDP on healthcare. Today, we spend almost double that, 17%, which fortunately, that share of GDP seems to have capped off, partly in part because of the Affordable Care Act, which is having a significant impact on more innovation. When you think about that, we are spending, you know, almost a fifth of our national income on healthcare and achieving outcomes you all know are far, far worse than our new international peers. Higher education, having been on both sides of this debate, both with innovators and legacies, you know, it's the only part of inflation that has really risen faster than healthcare costs, which is stunning in itself. It's twice as fast as the cost of medical care, three times as fast as inflation overall. So a significant part of what it means both to be middle class as well as to be able to prepare to be an entry level society is now becoming unattainable and out of reach and in need of that innovation. And then think about transportation. The average American spends, you know, over 100 minutes in a car. Us DC folks who live in the city may not appreciate that, but it's a lot of time. That translates into 25 days a year, or if you think about it, for those of us who don't get a lot of weekends, that would be a weekend a month that you're spent stuck in a car for the average adult American. And it's also the leading cause of death for folks aged 15 to 34 in America. So leading cause of death, that's more than suicide, it's more than poisoning, what have you. So figuring out how to fix that and take the human piece out would be really important. Now, I've mentioned that, you know, Bill's been a mentor and inspiration for much of innovation policy, and I think that's also true for the President's Strategy for American Innovation that we released 2 weeks ago, which I think attempts to get at, oh, great, I didn't even know we have copies here. That's fantastic. It's not as glossy or as beautiful as the book here.
Sorry, I don't have the
We're not after royalties. But I think you see in that report a number of the elements that Bill and Charles have put out, including, you know, trying to shift our thinking past just pipeline while still emphasizing the importance of federal investments. And so I'll actually maybe drill down into one example of technology just to think through and see how many of these factors play out, which, you know, may not be a place where you would think about a significant federal role given the role of innovators out there. And this would just be autonomous vehicles. And so there, the President's Strategy for Innovation both, you know, starts the pipeline, recommends that we double our federal investments in the R&D that would go into testing autonomous technologies, as well as ensuring that autonomous technologies can be consistent and adaptable to the humans who have to interact with them and human behaviors. But it goes beyond that to think about how can we weigh the market conditions and supportive policy to really get these fleets on the road in a way that can help, you know, take the air out of driving and also create a new platform for consumer demand and services to grow. So there, you know, we are committed to, by the end of next year, delivering on connected vehicle technologies to actually make these ubiquitous so that innovators can then have a platform to be able to innovate atop of. That's an important federal role that we see that I think supports some of this idea of going beyond just pipeline thinking, but to think about the market conditions. At the same time, even as we are proposing to invest more in our R&D in these spaces, we're also thinking about how can we take that sort of full development perspective and actually pull them out of the lab and get them onto the road, particularly by focusing on those demonstrations that we think have the potential to be market viable and commercially viable early on. So just last month, we actually announced a significant investment in three demonstrations across the country. One of which I'll highlight for you is in Wisconsin. You might not think of, you know, Wisconsin as a autonomous vehicle state, but it's an interesting place to actually test for the more commercially viable applications, which would be commercial fleet caravanning. And so actually have put out a pilot there with significant federal backing and private backing to see if we can get some of these deployments out there, hoping to inspire market participants to come behind. So that's just a short example of how much of this thinking, I think, has influenced how we in the policy realm think about what are the different tools at our disposal so we can go from beyond just thinking linearly about these investments that may be important to also creating the market conditions and market pool that can be supportive of those coming in. But finally, and I would echo a point that I think David raised, but drew out even more broadly, you know, the biggest lock-in effect right now in the economy is probably the employer system, which really means that if you don't have a job, you also don't have a lot of the benefits that we consider essential to an American standard of life. And so there's a piece of this, which is how do we ensure innovation can also translate into jobs growth, and that we lay the investments oftentimes in education and other spaces to prepare Americans to actually seize on and be able to weather transitions in the workforce. But also, how do we go even further than the Affordable Care Act to make sure that benefits and those attributes of a middle-class income are actually available no matter what shifts in, you know, models may occur? I think that's an important area for thinkers to be working on actively as we see these dramatic shifts in the economy. And I think that's one place where if you were going to write a sequel, you might consider adding a chapter.
That's great. Thanks, Jerry. Let me offer a few brief comments as an initial reviewer of the book, and then I'll turn it over to Bill and Chuck if they want to make any comments to the panelists' remarks, and then turn it over to the audience. One thing that hasn't been mentioned, which I thought the book did an excellent job of, was straddling an understanding of innovation from both the business slash markets perspective and the public policy perspective. I haven't seen that done as good in any other book. I wanted to raise just one or two nits from the book and from the presentation today. The first was this notion of the fact that, or your claim that the US suffers from, quote, IT connectivity below world leaders. If you look at US states, and compare US states to other countries, we have 6 of the 10 largest regions in the world for broadband internet and internet connectivity. And a recent study found studies and comparisons based on advertised speeds across countries are deeply flawed. Essentially, European Union broadband providers deliver only 74% of their advertised speeds, while US broadband providers deliver 101%. So there's a canard out there that US IT connectivity is not world class, and that's not the case. You know, I think the notion of jobless innovation in the book was interesting, because manufacturing does not create jobless innovation. Manufacturing gets all the jobs. The issue, which your book points out, is that those jobs have been created overseas, not often enough in the United States. So it's not really a jobless innovation problem, it's a jobless innovation here problem. I know coming from MIT, you're exposed to the thinking of Brynjolfsson and McAfee and the arguments that, you know, technology you know, destroys jobs, it does not create them. And this is obviously an ever more a topical issue with policymakers in Washington. And I think it's important to point out that, yes, technology destroys jobs, but it also creates opportunities to create new jobs. We have now about 815,000 Americans who are employed in mobile applications development. It's a set of jobs that didn't exist a decade ago. Technology created 1 million new American jobs there. So the challenge for policymakers is to lead the transition into new spaces of the economy, whether it's autonomous vehicles or space tourism or robotics, and ensure that the United States is a leader in creating new jobs from new technologies and capturing them here in the United States. Finally, JJ, kudos to you and your colleagues in the administration for this fantastic new strategy for American innovation. One thing that we would counsel the administration to think about is tasking each federal agency with creating and developing its own specific innovation strategy or agenda that undertakes a study evaluating how they can spur greater levels of innovation in the economic sectors that they touch. So the Department of Transportation needs its own innovation strategy for autonomous vehicles and intelligent transportation systems. The Housing and Urban Development needs a strategy for how the Internet of Things can affect buildings and the new software technology. Along with that, we would encourage the administration to insist that at least 5% of every federal agency budget be devoted to the deployment of new technologies that can proactively impact innovation in the sectors of the economy which they touch. I think that's kind of a way to get at some of the change agent forcing functions to address the technology lock-in that we see in a lot of these legacy industries. And finally, I think it's important that governments spend more time looking at some of the new innovation methods, techniques, and strategies coming out of the private sector. Jeff Immelt at GE has recently put in place a new program, essentially where he evaluates senior business leaders on courage. Courage to enter new marketplaces across the world, courage to introduce new technologies and new products. So at the start of your year at GE, courage is part of what you're told you're going to be evaluated on at the end of the year. So I'd love to see federal agencies evaluating their leaders on courage, on innovation. Make that part of the expectations of their performance requirements and of their reviews and of their promotions over the long term. So that we get some more of these change agents in government and set the expectation for it. And last point there, setting big, hairy, ambitious goals. You look at what SpaceX does, where Elon Musk has said that the goal of SpaceX is to make human life interplanetary. That's fantastic. Every agency in the government needs that kind of mission statement for how they can drive transformation across the economy. So with that, those are my comments. Chuck, Bill, any reactions you would have to those remarks?
Well, I want to talk briefly about the question of technology and jobs. Historically, there are periodic worries that technology is going to do us all out of work. You remember the Japanese factories that ran all night without anybody, with the lights out and nobody there. The IT revolution took us away from that here. And every time the technology has created more jobs than it has destroyed. The Green Revolution destroyed a lot of small farmers, but they became truck drivers or truck repairmen to transport the extra crops that were grown because of the Green Revolution. And that's a good prototype. But each revolution brings its own question. And I think, in particular, in the manufacturing business, because of the erosion of the industrial ecosystem that has supported manufacturing in this country, a lot of job-generating small and medium industries have not been able to expand and create jobs. So this is an area where the government can repair difficulties that were created by the export of a lot of manufacturing capability, leaving small and medium industry here high and dry. I don't think enough attention has been paid in the promotion of advanced manufacturing to the employment question. I think it's clear there's a lot of exciting technology that's going to greatly increase productivity. It's not clear at all what the employment implications are going to be. I think that's an important area for study. With that, I'll turn things over to Bill.
Sure, and just to add one comment further. Manufacturing and job creation, I think we need to look at it not only in terms of what the job creation is at the production and so on. With advanced manufacturing, those numbers may shrink further. But the importance of manufacturing is that it creates these rich value chains of firms and interrelated industry, including a large part of the service sector. So there are inputs into that production movement, right? And that's resources, but that's also industrial firms employ over 60% of scientists, so a large part of the innovation system is connected, you know, to industrial firms. That's also supply chains, component makers, so there's a very rich input side to that, you know, so we call it OEM production market. But on the bottom part is also a much larger sector, in addition to a large top sector, a much larger sector that consists of the whole distribution system, the whole retail system, the whole life cycle of the product we kind of maintain, enriched cycle. Those are much larger sectors on top and bottom of that production moment. And there are rich value chains of firms. So when you erase that production moment, you smash the value chains. You can restore some of that bottom value chain with a replacement good. But you don't restore the top end. It doesn't come back. So I think we've been doing this. David, your point is an important one. This is by no means the only source of this, quote, jobless innovation issue that we discussed in the book. But it's one that I think we need to understand in more depth. And this is not even really a subject of scholarship here. There's a huge debate now raging on technological innovation. We have these periodically every few decades. So far, history since the Industrial Revolution is that over time, there will be disruption for a period of time, but overall, there is invariably net job creation from the technological advance that creates productivity. You know, maybe we're an exception moment here, you know, as McAfee joins the party, but I think a lot of the explanation for what's going on in the last 10 or 15 years has really been a failure to pay attention to what we argue is one of the dynamics of innovation, this manufacturing So those are just a few thoughts. I mean, David, your point about this change agent role, and that's indeed, these sectors aren't, as you point out, not just going to change themselves. And as JJ, you explained, you know, there is potentially a governmental role here. Obviously, the dynamics of markets themselves, the dynamics of a capitalist market economy itself is a substantial driver for change unless it's disrupted by barriers. So there's a lot of factors that can help orchestrate, help support the entry of disruptive innovation. But change agents really are required. And, you know, I think we really need to examine and think about that model. Change won't just happen. It has to get driven by institutions, organizational models, coalitions, as David points out, but also dynamic individuals. We study in a chapter of the book the Defense Department. And the Defense Department reeling from disaster in the Vietnam War, which was terribly destructive to the internal organization of the department. So left the Army in a mess. And the combination of leadership within the Department of Defense Office of the Secretary, right, and a very dynamic, independent change agent organization, DARPA, over time were able to lead to a complete recovery of the department from a technological point of view and launch of what's called a revolution in military affairs with areas like precision and stealth and UAVs and a series of other technology advances that transformed the capability of that department. So we kind of look at that as a model of all of those changes, stealth, precision, strike, UAVs, were all opposed systematically by the services when they were originally. It was only the strength of leadership in the Office of the Secretary and the fact that technologies were available that really helped these emerge. So that's an interesting model, but of course not every sector has a Secretary of Defense. You know, I think, David, your point about looking at these change agent roles would be an important kind of add-on kind of step in scholarship, and JJ, we're pointing in exactly that same way if we come back to some of these Chuck issues, Chuck Ever. We haven't worn out our welcome. That would be, I think, an important area to kind of look at.
Great. Well, let's turn over to the audience for questions. I'll take them as I see them. Please introduce yourself and the organization you're with, Joel.
Joel Yudkin, High Road Strategies. Hi. Congratulations, guys. This book is about a couple of decades overdue. Not to be critical of you guys.
Yeah, we're takes a long time to publish.
Yeah, very slow publishing. No, seriously, I mean, we were talking about this linear model that's been operating, and it's tied to the way we look at the economic theory and how it and economic policy. And our understanding of technology, we're only now with this book, I think, does make a contribution by doing something very important. It takes the technology out as a thing in itself and makes it part of a larger, dynamic, almost organic process that human activity and human decision making are as critical and human context. And I really like it. We need to, your introduction of context, I see it as a very important part of it is demand pull. Demand pull has always been there. It's never been not a factor. I've had enough opportunity to research some of this in different areas to see that demand pull has always been a factor in how the selectivity of technology and how whether or not an innovation actually has an impact. But at the same time, the other question, the question here I want to get to has to do with these barriers to adaptation to innovation. And that a lot of these barriers are tied to interests and different, you know, basically the lock, you're defining the lock-in, and I'm eager to look at how you unpack all that and get at the lock-in. But those barriers in themselves are not irrational. They come out of a process of evolution in time. And my concern about the barriers is when you talk about what about the jobs, it's going to be affected, and so on, so forth. Those interests are there, and they have a legitimate place in the system. But there, in order to move to a place where those innovation may have a positive impact on the economy or on meeting social or public goods, you need to address the transition questions. And I'm just curious how you address, how you tackle, because that is a policy issue.
You want to start on that?
Excuse me?
Go
ahead. The question is, The barriers to innovation, the defended barriers to innovation in entrenched sectors, are there for a reason, and there are people who have an important interest in their jobs that are dependent on them, and there are going to be transition issues. If you're actually going to break them down, it'll be her people hurt. How are we going to deal with that?
Yeah, disruption is in itself. You know, the cause of an agent for change, and inevitably, that there are going to be positions within these legacy centers that are affected. But I think, you know, we've long ago learned that we need to look on the sunrise side of things, not just the sunset side of things. That at least the history since the Industrial Revolution has been that the introduction of new technology-based innovation waves has overall, over time, created new significant plateaus of growth. And that's really the picture of how an economy grows. These Kondriev, for the Russian economist who came up with this original concept in the early 1900s, and scholars like Schumpeter who built on it, these are disruptive. And there are deep transition problems, inevitably. But in the end, they historically have led to significant new sectors within the economy that create new plateaus that we move towards. And you know, in the end, the history of that 250 years, I think, bears out the strength of that model. And you know, disruptive innovation, which is limited in the legacy sectors, it's been clear in many cases. You know, we argue in the end, you know, the barriers stand in the way of bringing on new innovation technology waves. Of course, there will be disruption if we introduce advanced new energy technologies. But I don't think in the end we can argue that bringing on a major 21st century innovation wave around new energy technologies would be a bad thing over time for the economy. So, I mean, this is, you know, glass half full, glass half empty kind of argument, but in the end, I think the economic history since the Industrial Revolution bears out an argument that we need to keep bringing these innovation waves on. It's an important fundamental strength of our economy. That's how the United States has grown. You know, we did canals, and then we did railroads, and we did electricity, and we did, you know, the auto sector, and we did aviation, and we did space, and we did nuclear power, and we did computing, we did the internet. All of these brought new plateaus of gain into the economy. They don't disappear, they continue to evolve. And we need to keep doing that, and the fact that we've got barriers to that system is very important.
This is the other, if you look at other countries who take the problem you described very seriously and really get in the way, there's problems on both ends. If you just let the beauty of the U.S. is that people are resilient, and they understand that business are going to close and jobs are going to go away. It's hard for a business to close in a lot of countries. I remember when I was a kid, mechanization was putting coal miners out of business, and the union made sure that all those union members got paid off handsomely. That worked pretty well, but I'm not sure you can do it every time.
So congratulations, great job, useful work. One of the things that struck me about your comments was that you didn't really talk about the global ecosystem very much. Maybe it's in the book, but what struck me was if you think about manufacturing here and jobs going elsewhere, the jobless innovation, you know, we do this as part, we as an American economy are part of a global economy, and so it's the growth of markets around the world, if you think about the numbers that you were talking about, JJ, you know, well, the markets around the world are growing, and part of the reason why companies go and participate in those markets is to have access to the markets and to be close to the markets where they understand what the market requirements are, and they can respond to those market requirements more effectively if they're there and if they're here. So these, you know, the growth of global supply chains is really part of the picture. But the other thing I didn't hear you say anything about was taxes. The way the United States has the highest corporate tax rate is a huge folks that go elsewhere to produce. So I'll just throw those out there on the table and congratulate you again.
Yeah, I'll turn over to Chuck in a second, but there is a deep, you know, international analysis. There's only so many things in this fairly complicated book that we can cover. It shows the kind of focus on the U.S. and manufacturing folks in the audience here. But there is a deep global analytical frame and major sections on India, China, France, and Germany that go into depth on kind of a legacy sector analysis in those territories. And Chuck can add a few words on this. You know, in terms of the global supply chain effects, you know, as I mentioned in discussing the manufacturing side, there are economies in the world that are manufacturing-led innovation systems. Germany is the prime case, but you see it in strongly in Japan and Taiwan and Korea, and now China's ability to introduce production at a scale that nobody has seen before has got remarkable features of technology and innovation advanced within it, and new business models around it. So those are examples of manufacturing-led economies. They are weaker on the front-end innovation side than the U.S. is. So to some extent, they're the other side of the coin to what the U.S. model is. We're strong on the front-end innovation. We haven't paid as much attention to the manufacturing-led innovation in recent decades. We're paying a price for that. So our task, and people like JJ and David have worked on policies to try and introduce kind of a new technology approach to manufacturing, take advantage of the strength of our innovation system, and use it. Those countries that I mentioned have weaker end front end innovation, and boy, are they on this problem. I mean, I spent 2 weeks in China and Taiwan this past fall, and you know they are fully aware that they need to beef up their front end innovation to complement their manufacturing led innovation, because they understand the need for a full spectrum innovation system quite well, and they're working on it. And folks like David and JJ, we're now starting to address some of the manufacturing-led side of the innovation system. So this is the book doesn't attempt to argue that the U.S. needs to close the doors and recapture every imaginable job for every possible industry, low end or high end. You know, we're not making that case at all. Global supply chains are crucial. Industries have got to locate abroad to be close to the markets. All of that's the case, but why lose a part of what historically has been an important part of our innovation system? We don't have to do that. Chuck?
I think that'll do. Let's hear from somebody else.
Let's go front to back.
Robin Gaster. So I have a couple of points. First off, I think your basic structure is great. It provides a framework that you can really think about these issues in a very useful way. That's point one. Point two, I'm slightly confused about whether this is a book about legacy sectors or about manufacturing. Everything you've talked about today has been about manufacturing. I know there's other stuff in the book, but I wonder how much of your model and thinking is really manufacturing in disguise applied to other sectors. I have no complaints about your policy thoughts and ideas for manufacturing. But I'm really interested in these other sectors, because that's where the jobs are. That's where the transitions are coming thick and fast now. It was, we heard from David about the jobless innovation. This is a huge, huge, huge issue. I thought Steve's point about a million new programmers is a great point, but 3/4 of Americans don't have a college degree. They are not going to be taking those jobs, right? So the transition issue, and I was thinking about this when I walked into my bank today and there was nobody there. There was nobody, it's hollowed out. That sector is almost gone and will be gone fairly shortly. The driverless cars will be here shortly. I don't have quite the faith that the innovation people do that the future is going to be like the past. I'm concerned that Brynjolfsson is more correct than I hope. And it seems to me that we need to find ways to develop innovation policies that encourage specifically ways to use low-skill and medium-skill people in these jobs, in these sectors.
Robin, let me just say a word and maybe Chuck will want to push this out. But we focus, you can't cover everything, so we really focus on the manufacturing kind of case study territory today, and there is a significant amount about this, in part because we argue it's both a legacy sector and an innovation model. But there are, I think, it's fair to say, very deep and pretty rich material on service sectors,
yes,
right, like higher education, and the whole, the potential for entry of new online and blended learning models. There's a major section on healthcare delivery and limitations within the innovation system there, which is largely organized towards, you know, continued drug development. That's how we organize the system there, but that's not a broad model, we argue. So there are, in agriculture, industrial agriculture, you know, we take a deep dive into those systems as well, both U.S. models and international models. So there's a lot of material in here. When you confront legacy sectors, there's obviously more than one. And on your point of the whole productivity debate, you know, obviously time is going to tell, and we'll wake up in about half a century and have some better answers. And it's an ongoing debate, and I think it's a really important one. And Joel's point about the need to think about transitions, you know, is a significant one. And these ought to be the subject of kind of ongoing debate. The argument that we make in the book is that, hey, it's not simply a story of potential technological disruption of employment.
No, no, of course.
It's also a story of how we've actually treated a manufacturing sector, which plays a pretty significant role in economic scaling, we argue. So we're trying to put an additional story on the table here, not saying that it's this story, not that story.
Did you want to jump in
with comment? Sure. So I would say that as a policymaker, it's hard. You don't want to be a Luddite, and you don't want to buy into the lump of labor fallacy. At the same time, you don't want to get caught unprepared for trends that could put middle-class incomes at risk. And so I think, you know, David mentioned the number one source of employment for men without a high school, without a college degree, is, you know, being a driver. Well, for men without a high school degree, you know, half of them aren't working. So there's already some indications that we need to think about how do we actually make the gains of innovation more widespread. And there's no silver bullet, and I think this is a place where all the minds in this room should be actively engaged as we search for solutions. A couple of things that I think are interesting in that search is both the role of upskilling, the role of de-skilling, and also thinking about not just the worker side but the consumer side. So. McAfee and Bonvillian were mentioned here. I'm also a big fan of Katz and Golden. I think there has been a de-investment in the skills that are needed. I mean, it is a problem that only a quarter of Americans have a college degree. It's an even bigger problem that a far fewer number have access to the early childhood developmental skills that actually can make an individual more robust to changes over the course of their lifetime. So I do think, you know, as you see productivity lead to growth, we need to think about ways of reinvesting that growth into fundamental education. There's also a piece around here of de-skilling, which is, many people don't realize, but back in the 1920s and 1930s, to be a car mechanic, you had to have a college degree. That was the expectation. And so if you were to say, look, you know, auto repair shops are going to be a great source of employment growth, so forget that you're no longer driving your horse and buggy or what have you, you're going to be fine. People would have laughed in your face and said, sure, but only for a select few. One of the areas that we've been focused with on through our tech hire initiative is actually thinking about that phenomenon for computer programming. So how can you actually make it so that you don't have to have not only a college degree but a PhD in order to get into this field? And I think there's some really impressive results from boot camps and the like that show that you actually can train folks who may not have a college degree to do a lot of the tech processing capabilities that so many companies and so many industries need. And you know, I think that Google actually believes that as well. They just announced today, I think, that they are doing a partnership to make app development more accessible through working with a MOOC provider to more individuals. So I think that's an area to think about as well. How do we make it so that these jobs are created by the new economy aren't just accessible to those with only educations? And then finally, there is a piece around consumer demand, and this does actually go back to the manufacturing example, but if you, look at the work of Neil and others who sure say, how is it that manufacturing over time hasn't traditionally been associated with declines in local employment, even though it has been declined, it has been associated with increases in productivity? Well, they point to, as you come down the cost curve for many of these manufactured goods, you actually can have greater demand, which then leads to an associated level part of employment. Well, one of the biggest, I think, barriers to consumer demand right now is that we really aren't making that widespread. So if you look at the share of income that the sort of 90% who aren't in the top 10% capture, that's fallen from two-thirds to less than half. over the last couple decades. And so if you were thinking about where that consuming power will be to go into services, to be freed up, to actually generate employment, it's not clear that it's widely distributed enough in order to create that. So that's another place to think about, which is how do you actually create an ecosystem that can take innovation and lead to jobs growth? And I think there's a distributional aspect to that as well.
That's great. Stick on this question.
Thank you. My name is Paula Stern, and I completely agree on the computer programming because I worked so hard with the National Center for Women and Information Technology to try to get our youth in the pipeline, staying in the pipeline, particularly underrepresented minorities and women. But my question's about DARPA, because I agree, I think it's been the most remarkable government model that we have for innovation. It's been so successful, and my question is how to replicate that, a little bit a variation on your question, Stephen, to get the kind of innovation thinking, because the Defense Department provides the customer as well, and DARPA is based on commercialization, and it's built in from the very beginning that it's not supposed to be just for research. It's actually to be get out there and commercialize both the, for military and the civilian potential. So I'm wondering how you would tweak DARPA beyond where it has been so beautifully modeled now, to make it more of an engine, perhaps for manufacturing.
You know, there's a series, Paula, of DARPA clones, and some have been more successful than others. And I would argue probably the most interesting has been ARPA-E.
Yes.
And ARPA-E has exactly this problem. It doesn't, it's not a procurement, you know, the Department of Energy is not a procurement agency. Right, doesn't buy stuff like the Defense Department does. Now, the reality for DARPA is that maybe its most important set of advances were in the IT sector, and the Defense Department was not nearly as strong a procurement player in that area of advance than it was, say, for example, in stealth or in precision strike. So DARPA launches stuff into markets without necessarily using the full panoply of defense procurement support in many important cases. So it can do it, right? ARPA-E, however, lacks any procurement capabilities. So it's worked very hard on developing what is called a technology to market focus. And unlike any other R&D agency I've ever heard of, it's actually got a commercialization team. So you have the project director, the program manager, and the researchers that are getting funded to support, whether they're industry or universities or often both, in a hybrid model. Mm-hmm. But they're immediately teamed up with folks in this tech-to-market team that are going to work on designing a commercialization model. Mm-hmm. And ARPA-E in itself doesn't just think about, let's do neat research. It selects its research projects based upon whether there's actually a launch pathway to entering into market process, a plausible launch pathway. Mm-hmm. If you don't have one of those, they're not going to fund you. Mm-hmm. Right? So they've developed new models that are different from DARPA's. And interestingly, Cheryl Martin, who is the kind of first leader of the commercialization team at ARPA-E, is now talking to Arthur DeBacher at DARPA about that commercialization model because, frankly, defense procurement has shrunk.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not as powerful a force and technology advances it once was, probably. So DARPA is actually thinking about an innovation that ARPA-E has come up with. So we need to do this broader thinking, we argue. We think that some of the models we talk about in the book, you know, thinking communities and connecting operators to technologists and island bridge models, we think about some of those ideas are important when you start to think about this creating your early stage R&D agencies and making them more into change agents.
Bill, do you want to talk about some of the other clones? Because then we'll start exploring the difficulty of being a change agent.
Right. You know, some of the clones have worked better than others. And
you didn't mention SBIR, the Small Business Research Assistance.
Right.
What's your evaluation for...
Well, this gets into the whole technology transition issue.
You have to talk about that question, by the way.
All right.
Well,
thank you.
Yeah. Actually, I can tell you it's one of the most successful programs in the U.S. innovation system.
Mm-hmm.
But save that conversation.
Agreed.
I think I can just echo what Steve said, and Chuck can elaborate.
Well, I think it was you that originally told me this. The contrast is between SBIR and the old ATP program and the Bureau of Standards. Now you're getting into the politics of government programs. ATP was very picky about what it funded, and it had a certain number of friends from the people it funded, and then a lot of non-friends from the people it didn't fund. Whereas SBIR is a lot less picky and has a lot more friends.
All you need to know about the success of SBIR is that it's been replicated by countries throughout the world now.
Right.
Europe has its own version of it. England's put in place one. So I'm interested in putting there. But listen, this has been...
There's been a major evaluation by the National Academy of SBIR. And
Chuck Wessner
and company are very... very bullish on SBIR. They said whatever defects it might have, it's been extremely successful in promoting innovation in small industries.
He's influenced.
Well, I think Steve,
Chuck, go ahead.
Point the fact that
I didn't see you there, Chuck.
The fact the rest of the world is copying it is significant. I think there's more of a task for JJ to make sure that we don't audit it to death.
Mm.
You know, the stories that we're getting are more and more horrific about the, the taxi fares from 2006. I'm not joking. I wish I were. And the small companies are really not able to handle that level of oversight. You know, the basic start of it, which gets you compliant with Fed regulations, is great. It enables you to compete. And perhaps one of the best things you might want to think about elsewhere is that if you get an SBIR award and it's adopted, then you don't have to go through the formal procurement process as a sole source. And that was overlooked by a lot of people, but it's actually key. But I think Bill knows more about DARPA and RPE than anyone. I would just add that, based on what I've learned from you, Bill, DARPA doesn't always take these things into the market through procurement, and I think that's what you were suggesting. You know, the Siri, as Mazzucato talked about, was given as a gift to SRI from Stanford to, quote, commercialize. But I think their job was to take the money that Stanford didn't get and sell it to Jobs. That was their main purpose. But the thing that this administration can only be complimented in general for its innovation policy is the can you get a hybrid between the multiple SBIR awards and a DARPA slash RPE in fact really RPE because you've addressed and Bill should be recognized for that didn't appear by accident using that model to take more money from other agencies and use an RPE type model with this broad SBIR approach to avoid needing appropriations for an RPE model, which is an Achilles heel, because I understand it may be good for the economy and good for the world and good for American workers, but it was Obama's. So you have to make choices. But getting it out of their budget, which not agencies won't like. I'm not trying to make a speech here, but you can hybrid something there where you take away some of that vulnerability. Mm-hmm. SBIR would be gone if it had a budget line.
Oh, yeah.
Well, listen, we've gone about 5 minutes over, which means that Rob's going to dump my pay. But I think it's been a great conversation. I want to thank Chuck and Bill for their great presentation, and David and JJ for their great remarks, and you for coming out today. A video of this event will be available online at ITIF, and thank you all very much.